On behalf of the Nobel Peace Center and Right on Retail, it's a pleasure for me to welcome you to what we like to see as the peak of the Arendalsuka. It's going to be a conversation about food, climate, and peace. Welcome also to all of you following us on our YouTube stream today. I say peak of the week because the issue that we're discussing, food, climate, and peace, is absolutely critical. But it's also because we have some very prominent guests here with us today. We are so pleased to welcome to Arendalsuka for the first time, I believe, directly from South Carolina, the wonderful David Beasley. Mr. Beasley has just left the United Nations World Food Programme, where he served as executive director for 6 years, I believe, and where he also received a Nobel Peace Prize for the World Programme's work. The World Food Programme won the award for its effort to combat hunger, for its contribution to bettering conditions for peace in conflict-affected areas, and for acting as a driving force in efforts to prevent the use of hunger as a weapon for war and conflict. In his role, Mr. Beasley has created unprecedented awareness and unprecedented funding for the important war against hunger. We're so proud to have you with us today, Mr. Beasley. Also in our panel today, we're pleased to have the Norwegian Minister of International Development, Anne Beate Tvinnerheim, and Mr. Beasley calls you Anne B. I tried to pronounce it like Anne Beate, and he's like, oh, Anne B. We also have the director of the Nobel Peace Center, Kjersti Fløgstad. As you know, the Right on Retail is a proud partner of the Nobel Peace Center. We have the leader of Global Compact Norway, Kim Gabrielli. And we have, of course, our own CEO, Ole Robert Reitan. And I hope now that everyone has found a seat. What will happen now is I will start with the key. I just looked at my notes. Actually, I'm very happy that it's packed. We will start with a keynote by Mr. David Beasley, then Kjersti will host a conversation, and we will finish off with reflection from another honorable guest of yours, closing remarks by Bård Vegard Solhjell, director of NORAD, the Norwegian Agency for Development Cooperation. Very excited about that as well. So with that, please join me in welcoming Mr. David Beasley.
It is so good to be here. And the weather, oh my gosh. Back at home where I'm from, it's like 40-something degrees Celsius heat index. So when I got the invitation to come, I was like, you don't even have to ask twice at all. We're on the way. And Anne B., oh my gosh. Anne B. has been one of the greatest friends and allies of understanding what we're truly facing. When I took this job, reluctantly actually, Trump had gotten elected in the United States in 2016, taken office in 2017. So I got some phone calls from some friends saying they were very concerned about international funding under the Trump administration. And I said, well, you should be. And they said, would you consider taking a role? I said, no, I'm not interested in any role at all. I'm happy doing what I'm doing. So anyway, some of my Democrat and Republican friends in the Senate and House said, you've got to do this. You're the only one that can really reverse the thinking, because this is effective strategic aid that stabilizes nations, saves lives, and prevents mass migration, and it is absolutely vital to worldwide stability. And I'm like, well, tell me more. And so anyway, at the time, the World Food Program funding was about $5 point something billion. And with Trump cutting out the budget as to the World Food Program, our fundraising would have been $10 million per day. And so you can imagine it was a very big issue. So I agreed, with the commitment of the leaders in the Senate and the House and the Democrats and Republican coming together, in spite of the fact they're fighting on everything, it's like the miracle on Pennsylvania Avenue. Food brings people together, and it did. And I got the commitment from the leadership. And actually, at the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue, I was able to convince the White House that food is strategic to America's national security interests, et cetera, et cetera. And so by the time I finished, we were raising $39.4 million per day, 7 days a week, $55 billion that we raised. And I don't think we would have achieved that had it not been for the Nobel Peace Prize Committee that gave absolute clarity to an issue that was not getting its fair shake. I was out there drumming up as much political and media support as I possibly could. But in today's world, it's hard with the social media, the propaganda, and so much distraction to bring what I call icebergs in front of the Titanic versus broken wine glasses in the ballroom. And so I couldn't get the leaders to fixate and focus. But the Nobel Peace Prize Committee did two extraordinary things. One was, thank you, World Food Program, for your women and men who lay their lives on the line every day to help bring peace and stability to nations using food. The second was, I do believe, they clearly understood from my messaging and tweets that the perfect storm was coming upon us. And what we were seeing is just the beginning of a storm that we were going to have to face with every fiber that we possibly had. And so when I took this role, in April, stepped in the position April 2017, there were 80 million people marching towards starvation, not knowing where their next meal would come from. Chronic hunger is a different story. But I'm thinking 80 million people out of a population at the time of 7.6, 7.7 billion. Wow, former United States governor, set goals, benchmarks, measurables, we'll execute a plan. I'll eliminate the need for the World Food Program. That was the way I was thinking, because most people don't realize it, but 200 years ago, there was a population of about 1.1 billion. Now, of course, it's about 8 billion. But the extreme poverty rate was between 85 and 95%. Think about that, of the entire world. Today, less than 10%. So we have built systems, particularly empowering the private sector to hire more people, share more wealth than any time period in world history. So that is fantastic and great news. Now, try telling that 10% that we haven't reached yet that it's all so well and good. But you don't tear down the system that's reaching the 90 to reach the 10. We have to, with all of our heart and our mind and all of our experiences, do what we can to reach that final 10%. Now, having said that, in the last few years, we've actually been going backwards. So 80 million people, within 2 years, the number had jumped to 135 million. Why? Man-made conflict. This is, again, about 2019. Man-made conflict and climate shocks. Climate. And I would tell people, look, you can debate what's causing it all day long, but come with me and let me show you the droughts, the flash flooding, and the impact that it's having on the poorest of the poor in Asia and Africa, the Middle East, et cetera. Well, COVID comes along. Bam. The number went from 135 million to 276 million people not knowing where the next meal's coming from. But COVID did more than just impact the poorest of the poor in that way. It created extraordinary debt in developing nations, which we'll go into in just a little bit. And so just when you think it couldn't get any worse, and of course, I got this phone call. You know, you just don't get a Nobel Peace Prize phone call often. So we actually thought we might would get it the year before. And so everybody's all, you know, getting ready, I was going to be in Rome right there prepared with the suit and just in case, you know, and it didn't happen. And I told my team, do not ever think about this again. Never. Focus on what we do. If it happens, thank goodness. And so I was in the middle of Niger. I mean, Niger, if you've been reading about Niger lately, you can see why I was in Niger, because I had Al-Qaeda, I had ISIS. We were trying to move food into the certain places. And if you can't get the food in, well, they recruit by denying people food and medicines. And, you know, it's not like you can jump in a car here, you don't have food, and you can drive up to Oslo or anywhere you want to, Vivian, anywhere, you'll find food. Well, it's not like that there. And so I had mothers telling me, Mr. Beasley, my son, my husband didn't want to join ISIS or Al-Qaeda, but we hadn't fed our girl in 2 weeks. What were we supposed to do? And so they use food as a weapon of war, of division and destruction, like we're seeing now in the war in Ukraine. And so I was in there just having a very visceral meeting with the military leaders, pounding them, I've got to get access. You've got to allow me to get in here to reach these people. Otherwise, ISIS and Al-Qaeda and extremism is going to grow and grow and grow. And it is a pretty, and Anbiat can tell you, I'm a real positive guy, but I can be pretty tough guy when it needs to be. As we would say, turn the temple table over from time to time. And so I'm just pounding, and all of a sudden somebody busts into the meeting room. And I look up, I'm like, what the heck are you doing busting in this room? And it's my guy, Nobel Peace Prize. And I'm like, yeah, great, who won it? You did, we did. And it was an incredible day. And I am so grateful that I was in Niger. What better place in the world to receive the news and be able to speak to every major news outlet in the world from one of the most devastating countries on the planet that was facing extremist groups, destabilization through climate impact, and we had extraordinary successful programs because of friends like Norway that was giving us not just more money, but more flexible funding to achieve what we needed to achieve, and I'll get into that. So we get that phone call, amazing things happen. The world began to become aware. And so I was started then getting the invitations that I needed to the G7, the G20, speaking to the prime ministers and the presidents and having private conversations and laying out how bad it really is in these countries and those countries. And then within a matter of about a year, it was pretty interesting to watch presidents, prime ministers, and foreign ministers quoting your quotes. And why that's important is it meant they were getting it. And that was critical without having to be fed a line by staff. So that was extremely good news. Now, as I was making the argument then, if we don't reach the people and we don't get the monies that we need, here's what's going to happen. So I was speaking to the parliaments, particularly the major parliaments that do extraordinary funding. You know, Norway's one of the biggest funders per capita in the world by far, in addition to what they do on an international basis in foreign relations, above the fold and below the fold in terms of helping bring peace and dialogue. And I'll talk about that later because it's quite extraordinary. I cannot tell you how much impact Norway has on the world, particularly today when leaders are not doing what they need to do around the world to address the icebergs in front of the Titanic, whether it's Russia or Syria, and I can go on and on. And so the funding, we moved from 5-point-something billion up to 6, up to 8, up to 12. Well, just when you think it couldn't get any worse, and we had pretty much, as you remember, in COVID, it was all the lockdowns around the world, and I remember Tony Blair called me, and I was the first public international figure that got COVID, and because I was just traveling, and so anyway, BBC, CNN was wanting to talk to someone they knew that was international. How's it going? And I was feeling actually pretty good. And then it's like a week later, I've crashed. And so anyway, Tony called me. He said, David, the young people, Tony Blair was the former, prime minister of UK. My children remind me how much, anyway, you get it. And so he said, what are you seeing out there? He said, you go to more places on the planet than anybody I know. I said, Tony, I am very worried that if we're not careful, these lockdowns and shutdowns are going to kill more people than COVID. We've got to balance it out. It's not one against the other. We've got to balance this thing out so that supply chain systems can move. Otherwise, people will die from malnutrition, and you don't have the right nutrition, then your immunity system crashes, and you die not just from COVID, but from cholera, diphtheria, and many other diseases. And so he said, you've got to immediately go to the Security Council and let them understand how bad this really is and why we must really rethink how we impact supply chain systems and moving cargo around the world, because you remember the airline industry was pretty much shut down. Well, the World Food Program, when hell breaks loose, everybody's running out, we're going in. And so we were carrying almost all the COVID equipment, from PPE, testing equipment, the whole nine yards. And we were moving supplies and, where's Morgan? I saw him a minute ago, ambassador. We were moving ambassadors and humanitarian workers all around the world because airlines Africa weren't moving. They weren't moving anywhere. And so anyway, we got through that time period with extraordinary funding because the leaders got it. They got it. They understood the impact. And you had good questions you would get from, didn't matter whether it was from the left or the right, whether it's in UK or Germany or Norway or United States. Why should I send money down to Guatemala or Chad when I've got road problems, I've got healthcare issues, educational funding issues right here at home? And I would say, well, if you're not going to do it out of the goodness of your heart because you love your neighbor and care for the poor, well, let me give you a couple other reasons. Because here's the cost when we feed, for example, a Syrian in Syria at 50 cents a day. That same Syrian, who, by the way, when you feed like we did last year, 160 million people on any given day, week, or month, like if I fed everybody in Arendal every day for 2 years, I'd know what's going on in your city. I can tell you pretty much everything that's going on, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Well, we survey people all the time. And people, in spite of what propaganda may say, they don't want to leave home. They don't. People are pretty much the same, creating the image of God, but this basic nature, worldwide, they're the same. They don't want to leave home. There are exceptions to that, but if it's migration by choice, that's usually a pleasant debate versus migration by necessity because they have no choice. They have no food. They have no peace. They have no stability. And normally, they'll move 2, 3, 4, 5 times before they'll actually leave their country. So I'll give you a very simple example. This is really not a complicated study. It's about a 5-minute study. Germany, 1 million refugees over a 5-year period, $175 billion, euros. That's over 70 euros per day per person. That doesn't include all the costs versus what? 50 cents a day. Do the math. 140 times more. Don't even want to be there. It's not they just don't like Germany, but they want to live and take care of the children. And I can assure you, every one of us in this room have children. We would have done the same thing to survive and protect our children, get them out of harm's way so they can get food. It's just the reality of life. And so people don't want to leave. And if we can reach them where they are with the programs that they need, then it's a lot cheaper. And I use the illustration, if you've got like a leaking water line in the ceiling of your house, it costs you $100 to go up there and fix that leaking water line. But you don't have $100. And you say, yeah, you know, I have $100 and I got this. And well, a month later, you got to replace the oak mahogany dining room table, the flooring, the carpet, the chairs, and it's a $10,000 fix. So take your pick. It's one or the other. There's not an option C. And so with this simplicity, I've been able to make the case to the most liberal or the most conservative members of parliaments around the world that this is a good investment, as well as in your national security interest. So our funding, really, we were able to move it up to $39.4 million a day. And I say that because when I got there, I had a goal, how I manage my time strategically every day, where I sit on the plane, how fast I can get off, how many meetings can I get in, all these things, 7 days a week, what it takes to achieve raising an extra $2, 3, 4 million per day. It's time management. Flying, 1/3 of my time was in Rome, 1/3 was in the war zones. 80% of our operations were in war zones. So we got to go there, and then I would fly from a war zone. Might have been Haiti or Ethiopia or Afghanistan, and I'd fly to a capital and give a talk so that the ministers could build the support they needed for the funding or maybe the flexibility of funding to change the way we do things in certain countries. So anyway, I left you with we were $276 million, and we think it can't get any worse. Well, Ethiopia, Afghanistan, then the breadbasket of the world, Ukraine. The number is now about 345 million people who don't know where the next meal is coming from, a different number than chronic hunger, 345 million people. So here we are, and the funding, I remember I did some pretty hard, tough TV stuff with Elon Musk and Bezos and Zuckerberg, because during COVID, the net worth increase of the billionaires was $5.2 billion per day of the net worth increase. The cost of war is $17 trillion on our GDP, $430 trillion worth of wealth on the planet. And we've got a child dying from hunger around the world about every 4 to 5 seconds. Shame on us. Now, I believe in capitalism, but I do believe with wealth you have a shared moral obligation to engage. Now, before I get to that, we were able to raise that extra $6 billion because of countries like the United States and Norway, and especially Germany and a few others that stepped up. I hate to tell you this now, but the funding level for 2023 now and 2024 is going to be less than $10 billion, maybe even $9 billion. Right now, they're cutting rations in countries all over the world. Now, one of the things that I truly believed in, and Anbiat and I have talked about this as well as with many other members of the parliaments around the world, is give me the flexibility to take that same dollar that we're just feeding people, because I can assure you that most people that I know, I say most, probably about all, they don't like handouts. They want to take care of their own families. And if you want to understand capitalism without going to Harvard Business School, give the tools to an African woman. And I can assure you, I have seen it firsthand. It's the most inspiring thing I've ever seen in my life. I could sit here and talk for hours about that. So particularly in places like in the Sahel, Niger, Mali, Burkina Faso, Chad, Sudan, South Sudan, where we can come in, and I felt like every able-bodied adult, because every mother, father that I met in these very devastatingly poor areas, they want to grow their own food, take care of their own families. Because smallholder farmers grow 75 to 80% of the food, like, for example, in Africa. But they need the tools, and now they're being devastated by climate. So if you make that case that climate's being caused by Western industrialization, developed nations, well, they didn't do it. And now are they paying the price? If you believe that, then you have a moral obligation to give them the tools to adapt in this interim. While you're talking about mitigation, you've got to have adaptation for the people to survive. Otherwise, not only are they going to die, but they're going to be migrating your way in unprecedented numbers. So here's what we've done. We rehabilitate, and I say we, the World Food Program, working with many of our partners out here, UNDP, UNICEF, but the key people were our beneficiaries. We rehabilitated over 4 million acres of land that was not growing any food and that's now growing food for people and for the animals. And we would take places where you have, for example, the herders moving down into the farmers and the fighting that would go on and extremist groups trying to exploit that and destabilize areas within these particular areas. 109,000 holding ponds and small dams and reservoirs. 79 to 81,000 kilometers of feeder roads that we built. 29,000 kilometers of water canals and irrigation lines. I can go on and on. And it's amazing to see what happens. So when Ukraine hit, the villages, for example, in Niger, that we had put in these type of resilience programs that Anabiat and others were giving us that flexibility to do. So when we could go in there and help put down the water systems, so they have the water and the irrigation lines, I've got some of the most amazing videos. So I would go back 2 years later, and my team, like, and a lot of people like to go and talk about ideas, but not execute ideas. And when I got to the UN, I can assure you that I wasn't well-liked in the first year, because I would say, how long have you been in this country? Oh, 30 years. Well, maybe it's not working. You know, maybe you ought to rethink it a little bit, or what's going on? It's not happening. Anyway. So anyway, I remember Biba had nothing. I came back 2 years later, and she stood there like she was Bill Gates with so much pride. And, well, Bill Gates maybe doesn't have that right pride. But anyway, she did. She was smiling from ear to ear. It's hard to get Bill to smile. But anyway, she showed me all the communal farm that they had. And she says, not only are we feeding our families in our village, we're selling now into the marketplace. And we're buying our children clothes and medicines. And I just paid for my son's wedding. I mean, it was so touching. So 80% of the villages that we put resilience programs in did not need support when the Ukraine crisis hit. And that crisis is still ongoing. And if you remember what happened when the invasion began on the Eastern Front and all the political leaders were fixating on the Eastern Front, and I'm like, that's just part of the battle. The biggest battle is the coastline, because Ukraine is the breadbasket of the world. 400 million people eat because of Ukraine, and we've got to open up those ports. So I tried to be strategic in tweeting to Putin, because I knew if I went just pure negative on him, he would probably do like Trump or others and just go to a corner and just whiplash back. I said, I got to find a way to get his attention and say, hey, Putin, don't bring famine to the rest of the world. Show the world you care. And we negotiated the Black Sea Grain Initiative and got it going. But now it's falling apart. Now, we don't have time to get into all of that. But the reality we're facing now is real. I began immediately with the Ukraine invasion, meeting with the presidents, prime ministers, foreign ministers, development ministers, ag ministers, saying you have to assume that agricultural production in that region is going to be diminished, particularly from Ukraine. So you've got to take advantage of every available piece of land you've got everywhere. Talk to climate activists saying, hey, we've got to be practical here. We got to get through these next few years. It was incredible practical response by a lot of different groups out there that I was really proud of. That surprised a lot of people because we were facing such a storm. So here we are. There we were. We're still going in the wrong direction. And the situation is not improving. Fuel cost, food cost, fertilizer cost, extraordinary debt now in African countries where more money is going to debt than for education and health care. They don't have the ability for health safety net programs now. So we got through these crises with safety net programs helping stabilize and keeping people alive so there wasn't political unrest. But now you're seeing extraordinary political unrest around the world, from South America to Asia to Africa, the Middle East. And it's going to get, in my opinion, worse, because we have not seen the worst of the worst. And we can get into the economic indicators of that. Now, when you compound that with the fact that the World Food Program's funding is dramatically dropping, I would say, if not the end of this year, next year, you know, it's going to get really, really bad. And so what I do believe as we go forward, let me just touch on a few things. I know I need to wrap down. But long-term, short-term. Short-term, we've got to, you know, save as many people, keep them alive as much as we can. And philanthropy is important. But philanthropy is not the long-term solution here. The long-term solution is the private sector. And this is where I've been, you know, trying to awaken the UN and saying, look, you know, our goals and objectives, the sustainable development goals, are extremely, extremely important. But we're not going to get there through philanthropy. Look at the systems that we built in the last 200 years by empowering the private sector and walking alongside and encouraging and finding that right balance out there. So the answer is not what can the private sector do to help the United Nations. No, it should be the United Nations. What can the United Nations do to inspire and empower the private sector to come in countries and be willing? And I'm talking to CEOs privately right now all around the world, and to stock an analyst saying that they have a social responsibility. We have a social responsibility, like you do on climate, but not just a one-off and feel good and take a video and a nice picture and put it on your web page, and that's nice. That's great. I'm not opposed to that. I'm for that. That ain't going to change today. You've got to engage. And you're going to have to get granular. You're going to have to go into countries, and the CEOs are going to have to make absolute commitments. We're going to do what's necessary. I'm not talking about going into Sudan right now or going into Niger today, but there are probably 25, 35 other countries in Africa. We can go in and start developing the supply chain systems, eliminate the corruption that's necessary and critical, and I could go very granular on what it is going to take. And it's going to take CEOs calling the president of a country and saying, you've got a problem here. I will invest here, but you've got to solve this. And we can get into the details of that, not today. But the private sector, in my opinion, is critical. In the private sector, particularly creating the wealth and making the money, they're in the business of making money. But as I'm telling the analysts, allow the shareholders and these corporations to understand that in these countries, you got to be willing to make a little bit less over a longer period of time, and be a little bit less efficient. Not to the point it's devastating to your company's bottom line. I get that. But until and unless that happens, because why are these other countries around the world, like Norway and the United States, have such extraordinary economies? Because we have built systems and supply chains and rule of law that allow for market opportunity from anyone on the planet, and we just need to give them the tools and get out of their way. And so my question to the United Nations is, what do you need to be doing to empower and inspire private sector? Yeah, but look at that corporation, what they did 8 years ago. I'm like, okay, you know, I've had UN officials say, well, I don't want to, we just shouldn't take that money and help those people over there because of what they did 10 years ago. And I'm like, you know, if I got all the money I need, I might take that argument. But I got a million people over here who go starve to death. And I want you to go stay with them and starve with them. Get off your little ivory tower and tell me you think that's what you ought to do. It's not a perfect world. And the world is very divided right now. And we got to be more forgiving and loving and caring than any time period. So let me end right this. I was doing a major, you know, 60 Minutes in the United States, probably the most impactful documentary program in the world. And so Scott Pelley and I were doing a heck of a tough story. And it broke open the Yemen crisis on the coalition of the blockade in Hodeidah in 2017-18. That's another story. But so we were doing the interview, and it was a 30-minute, just massively powerful program. I had more senators in the White House calling me, said, my granddaughter came running, Daddy, granddaddy, granddaddy, you can't let them die, you know. And so within a week, we had the blockade down. But anyway, Scott said at the end, we're taking the mic off. He said, Governor Beasley, and Scott and I have known each other. He said, you've got the greatest job on the planet, saving lives of people. And I said, Scott, I do. But I'm going to tell you something that's going to bother you. And he looked at me like, what could that be? And I said, Scott, I don't go to bed at night thinking about the children we saved. So I said, Scott, I go to bed at night brokenhearted over the ones that we can't reach because of lack of money. And I said, when we don't have enough money, Scott, our teams have to choose which children eat and which children don't eat. We have to take food from the hungry children to give to the starving children. I said, how would you like that job? And of course, like anyone, he was just blown away. He said, oh my God, I never thought about it. And I said, well, we don't have to think about it. We have to act on it every day. And so when there's $430 trillion worth of wealth and the private sector is out there with answers and solutions, they got to engage more than they ever have. So this is why I'm so excited to be here, to thank Norway, inspire the private sector, encourage my friends in the NGOs who are out there every day fighting it and need the help from the private sector to come out and provide solutions around the world. So I'll close right there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. You're a rock star. Oh, this is so touching. And now we're going to have a panel dialogue. And I'm so proud and happy to announce. But first, I perhaps should say who I am. I'm Kjersti Fløgstad. I'm the director at the Nobel Peace Center. And I'm going to host this dialogue now for some minutes. And with me and with David on stage, we have the Minister of International Development, Anne Beate Tvinnereim. Welcome up. And we have Ole Robert Reitan. You can stay there. And then Ole Robert, you come over here. And then we have Kim Gabrielli, the head of the UN Compact Norway. Give them a big hand. And with all this you covered within this very short, the time flew when I was listening to you. So where do we start? Anne Beate, would you like to share some thoughts? And you're actually on that ship looking at the iceberg, aren't you? Mm. And what's on your horizon, and how do you deal with this? What is your strategy to step up and continue?
I can tell you it's keeping me up at night, just as it has with David for many years. But, you know, we knew since 2014 that the numbers of starving people in the world were was exploding, really. It was the first sustainable development goal that started to sort of backdrop. And unfortunately, we needed a war on our own continent to sort of really realize how things are interconnected here. But one thing that Davis has taught me is that, you know, never waste
a good crisis.
Because at least there is momentum now, because people are seeing, you know, food security is finally being raised at the international arena, and David Beasley is definitely one of the heroes behind how he managed to make that happen. But there are a couple of things that I'd like to mention as David's legacy. One is to connect the dots between food security and national security. You know, for us, we take our food security for granted. But if you talk to an agricultural minister in an African country, he doesn't talk about food security. He talks about national security, because he see that connection about how instability increases when people don't know where they're going to get their next meal. And another thing that I'd really like to stress is how we need to step up on resilience, and how really David Beasley turned WFP around to think preparedness, resilience, and everything we do. Because the situation on the African continent is that their own food production, their own resilience has decreased year by year, and their dependency on very expensive imports has increased. And that is, from my point of view, that is a global food system that is broken. Mm. And we need to change that for the sake of especially the African countries. And if I can just, I'd like to give one example, and I don't want to be rude to our hosts, but I'm going to tell you a story.
But
we've been in this situation before. We were here in 2008 when food prices around the globe soared, and we had the same kind of international food system where Norway and Ethiopia or Somalia or Kenya relied on the same global food supplies. And I worked in Mozambique at the time, and I remember how when the prices of rice, a staple food in Mozambique, tripled basically overnight, and we had social rioting in the streets. I had to be in house arrest because it was too dangerous to walk around, because when people don't have food, they become angry. And around the world, I mean, in many Asian countries, they put in place very strict penalties for stockpiling, you know, to try to get the food out there. And I sat in my house arrest, and I read one of the online newspapers, Norwegian newspapers, and I saw how Rema 1000 could calm down the Norwegian consumers, because they had been able to stockpile some rice from the global market so that Norwegians could, you know, we could rest assured we would get our Friday taco. Yeah. And it just goes to prove, you know, this we need to invest in self-sufficiency in many of these countries so that they become less dependent on these global food systems, because rich countries like Norway will always get food from that market, but these countries won't. And then we will have starvation, we will have social unrest, and we will never reach the SDGs.
Do you also share David's belief in the private sector? What is your thought about, you know, he says market, the system, food system is important. What are you thinking, and how do you think around that?
Of course. So we are never going to feed the world without private sector. There are 33 million small-scale producers of food in Africa. Most of them self-subsistence farmers. They never get to produce for a market, but they are businessmen that could not only produce for their families and their local communities, but they could create jobs along value chains if they were able to supply the local and regional markets. And it's a great investment, because the African continent imports food for $75 billion US dollars a year. Imagine if they could use that money creating jobs and livelihoods for the wrong producers. So that's how we need to turn things. And then we really need private sector.
So what do you think a little bit? Is it a good investment? Is it possible?
Definitely.
Do you have any examples?
I think, first of all, I have to say that I'm extremely proud that we are hosting this event. Isn't this fantastic? And then I'm scared to death by David's intro here for the 30 minutes that you started. And also a little bit confused because we have... I'm so blessed to be a food producer, food distributor, food promoter. We have food consumption, food waste as the maybe the most important issue on the planet, not only for hunger and starvation, but also for the environment, for public health, and so many questions. So I'm right in the middle of, I feel, almost everything that matters in a way. And that gives me also a little bit of confusion and some questions here, because we are always talking about environment. ESG for us right now is mostly about sustainability. And if we want to make sure that we as a private sector can help and encourage production and healthy businesses in Africa, in South America, in Asia, we need to import more. At the same time, just a couple of hours ago, I was standing on the other side of Poland here and talking about producing more, importing less, because we need to produce more here. For example, we want to exchange palm oil and soy oil with proteins that we can grow here. So, and if we were to reach that goal, we could reduce the import of soy and palm oil from poor countries that needs to produce more, not less. So you have to help me to find the answer on that question, because right now I'm going to, every year in Arendal, I get a little bit wiser. Now I feel just very, very stupid at the moment.
I call people like you.
No, but you told me actually yesterday that you don't see any conflict between producing more in, for instance, in Norway, be even more self-sufficient than we are now, and still being a part of the big international problem.
No conflict at all, isn't it? You know, African production, because they're importing food, which they should be, number one, feeding themselves. This will sort of, you have a short-term, long-term goal. First is stabilize smallholder families so they're not exploited by extremist groups and have to migrate or die or yield, this kind of thing. First, stabilize them and give them the tools they need to feed their families. Two, help the country grow enough food so they feed their country. Three, all that going on, then let's see what we can do to help that country sell food in the region. Okay. Now, Africa can feed the world, but that's a long way from now. In the meantime, what can we do to help stabilize Africa? Because I heard Museveni, the president of Uganda, and he and I've had some pretty hard talks. He said, David, if Europe doesn't come to Africa, Africa's coming to Europe. That's his quote.
Yeah.
And he's making the point. Come in here and investment. And I said, yeah, but you need to help your brothers and sisters clean their act up around here too, you know, on corruption, transparency, and things like that, which is another discussion that I get pretty vitriolic about in private. But I don't think it's a competitive issue at all, because we've got to increase production. What does Norway need to do? What does the rest of the world need to do, and especially every country, every region, to identify which minerals or resources would jeopardize our national security if a rogue country decides to exploit their possession of these particular minerals? Well, obviously, in the most recent few years, 2 years, people understand it. So what do we do on agricultural fertilizer production so that you're not held hostage? Because as I've said, worldwide, for example, on fertilizer, because Russia is the number one producer of fertilizer in the world, of export-based products and materials. I said, I don't care if you love or hate Russia. You don't get their fertilizer, I can assure you that half the people on the planet will not eat next year. And last I've heard, you can't go a few weeks without eating. So you've got to figure this thing out. In the meantime, because you can't go in and increase fertilizer production overnight. I know Yara's here, amazing partners of helping fight through these issues, of reaching people around the world, because fertilizer doubles the production of food around the world. And the fertilizer is absolutely essential. So when the Black Sea Grain Initiative was going on, I was pounding the streets saying, look, we've got to move the fertilizer from the Russia area as well as the rest of the world. We've got a lot of things we've got to work out, and we negotiated quite a bit of that. But you can't put together a multi-billion dollar fertilizer facility. It's not a cheap fix. It takes time, and it takes a lot of money. But we can't stick our head in the sand and assume that that war is, and I told leaders around the world, this war is not going to end in a few months. And I can assure you, you need to be prepared, because you can't ship, truck, trail the food out of Ukraine, even if they can grow it. And that's a whole other issue, because production is down 50%, more in certain products and less in other, like corn. But because it's all their whole infrastructure system is based upon the port, everything, the number of trains per day that come in, et cetera, et cetera. And so you got to assume that this war's going to go on, and you will not have Ukraine food. And we not, do you want to continue to rely on Russian fuel and fertilizer? If you do, then you need to prepare to pay the price. And I got things to say about that, about how the West has mishandled some of these issues, but that's another discussion. In the meantime, you need to think long term. Where are we vulnerable in our nation from certain resources that jeopardize our people, their way of life, and their national security? And you got to make some hard decisions. And Adamiat and I talked about this as well. There's not enough money in the humanitarian development world on international aid to do everything. It's just not. And you got to now be strategic. What are the icebergs out front? And you got to be willing to say no to friends. Say, look, I know you want a nice new couch in your house, but the house is burning down, and we'll fix that later. In the meantime, let's put the fire out and save our whole system. So anyway.
So no conflict. That's good to hear. No, but conflict. Now we had another issue with the sanctions. And Kim, what do you think?
What's the last thing you were saying, David, because I don't know if you... Let's put it into the larger perspective here. So the revenue of the World Food Program is the same as Right on Retail. Nothing bad about Right on Retail, but it's a relatively small retail chain in the world compared
relatively
to...
Relatively small?
compared to Walmart, I think, if I may say so. And I think this is the fact, guys. One retail chain from the Nordics is the same amount of money as the World Food Program has in a good year when there's crisis. And this is the starting point of this discussion. So there's no way around not including the private sector on a systemic discussion. Because we, like you said, David, this is just the consequences of a system that doesn't work, right, that we're seeing. Mm. No, the World Food Program does a great job. Of course it does. It got the Nobel Peace Prize. But the starting point is that the UN has to start talking and working with the private sector. And that's... The UN Global Compact is trying to start that discussion. But this is exactly what we haven't been doing for several years. I mean, you have done it with World Food Program when you were there. I mean, you really did. You were a pioneer in this work. But this is really the starting point. And
yes, because David actually challenged the UN to do more. And what do you actually do in the UN? Can you tell us that? what is actually happening?
Yeah, so
you are the
you used to work in UNICEF just like myself, so there's a lot of things to say. I mean, the World Food Program, like UNICEF, is doing, as an example, is with the little money they're doing, UNICEF is delivering vaccines to half of the children in the world. So the UN does a lot of great things.
I was
thinking, could have done much more. And I think in the partnerships, I think we see a UN that is forward leaning now. But I think we need to have CEOs like Ole Robert, but also from many other international corporations coming together and being willing to look at the system. Because, of course, I mean, it's 30% of the emissions in the world, but it's 100% of all we're eating, right? So how are we going to approach this? And I think this is exactly where we are starting at in the UN Global Compact. We are still early on engaging in the area of food, but this is... certainly one of the most important areas we have, because we need to decouple economic growth from emissions and from all the natural resources we are taking out. And that is a big chunk of that is the agricultural sector.
Exactly. Andrea?
No, I just wanted to, how do we do this? Because as a minister of development, I see that my, well, yes, I have a big budget, but it only goes this far. and the needs are increasing, and it's becoming more and more urgent. So how do we use that ODA money, or that, you know, the traditional development aid, to unleash that private money? And I think there's a lot that can be done to implement guarantee mechanisms, etc., so that you are willing to take the risk to invest in markets that obviously are risky. But I mean, we have done it with success on renewable energy in many countries. Mm-hmm. We can do that on agricultural production as well. We need to help each other, because ODA is only going to take us this far. But we can unleash more private investment.
And I think private sector is lots of money, and it's a market creator, but not at least it's competence. I mean, logistics, for instance, Robert, and the way that you are kind of thinking and professionalizing. And I would assume that many organizations would learn, and in partnership you could perhaps...
Yeah, we have lots of know-how to export, and we are doing that, and we are prepared to do more. And I think for this relatively small company, we are actually...
Sorry about that.
We are 43,000 people waking up every morning, and we have found the meaning of life, I think, now, because we know over the last 10, 15 years, we have become more and more aware of the fact that we are in a business where we can actually make change. And we tell each other every day that we want to invest our time on things and projects that make us sleep well at night, because we know that we are on the way to something, and we know that we can make a change. So, and I think this is not only for us, this is the private sector in total. This is how you attract the best people. This is a part of our recruitment philosophy and strategy, to just make sure that we are doing well, so we get the best people to come and work for us as well. So I see a small light at the end of the tunnel, hopefully not the train, but there's always hope.
Yeah, and creating jobs, creating livelihoods. You have you told me about this rose import. Would you like to tell shortly about that story? What?
Very, very shortly, because I think we're...
Yeah. But I mean, that is an example of what you...
Yeah, but we have to start... We have done a lot of microfinancing in different African countries, and we are also trying to work closely with flower farmers that you have actually... that made you change your behavior from shopping at expensive flower stores to go to Rema 1000 to buy your African roses there.
Yeah.
And she told me they are much better quality, half the price, fantastic. And the best thing about it is that we are actually paying the farmer better, because there are less players in the value chain between the farmer and the store. So you have a better paid farmer, and you have a better quality and a lower price at the store.
And less emission, because you'd fly the roses
less emissions
directly to Norway.
So it's a win-win-win.
Isn't it? And these kind of partnerships and businesses is what we... So can we see more grants and help?
Absolutely, absolutely.
This is part of the strategy.
There's no way reaching the SDGs without a forward-leaning private sector. And I want to comment, not only you, but I mean, the Norwegian business is really forward-leaning and really taking social responsibility. And I see it every day in my job, and I just want to applaud that.
We're such a small company.
We could have discussed so many things, and apologies, because I know that all of you have. But one thing that I want just to touch upon, because listening at all of you, there's something that drives you.
Yeah.
And I just want to hear, what is it? And what is it that make you kind of do all this and have this broader agenda and broader horizon? Where does it come from, David?
Well, I think everybody's got their own path to that. I remember the Nobel Peace Prize speech. I quoted Jesus of Nazareth, and whether you see him as a man or as a prophet or as a savior, I sort of see him as all three. The teachings of love your neighbor, which you can go to every religion in the world, and that is a sort of the center of every cultural religion there is.
And so that old teaching of love your neighbor, which is in the Torah, it goes back thousands of years. I had this rabbi, he said, you know, it really doesn't say in the ancient translation, love your neighbor as yourself. And I'm like, you're kidding me. He said, it's actually love your neighbor as your equal. Mm. Because every human being is created in the image of God, and therefore everybody's equal and everybody's special. And whether you're atheist or of any other religion, the practicality of seeing everybody as equal has just extraordinary dynamic, positive political implications. It ends racism, discrimination. You don't have to see things like I see. But if we can come together and call each other, you know, not Republican and Democrat, and, you know, I fuss at my Christian friends. A Baptist Jesus doesn't talk to the Catholic Jesus. I don't know what the Norwegian Jesus talks to. But the point is, we should be calling ourselves, hey, brother, hey, sister. That was the language Jesus used. And regardless of your faith, coming together in this spirit, this is the spirit that will change the world. That we're all brothers and sisters. We should forgive each other because brokenness is the number one problem on the planet. And right now in America, there's more division and brokenness than I've ever seen. And so I'm challenging people all over the planet right now to, I don't care what your background is, I want you to be willing next week to go invite somebody that's not like you to lunch. Don't talk politics. Just get to know your families and your story. It's amazing. My biggest enemies on the political floor are my best friends. We respected our differences. We respected each other. And we would fight it out. And people would see us go to dinner and have the best time. And how do you do that? I said, well, that's what makes the world go around. We're different. And I don't care what the issue. I'm going to respect you if you're going to be respectful. And let's agree to be different. Let's agree to love each other regardless of those differences and care for one another. Because I think we all want the same thing in life, a better world, a safer place. And let's do it together. And right now with the poor in the world, if every business in Norway would reach out, yeah, you might not need another employee, but reach out and get every one of your employees to reach out. If you got 43,000, imagine 43,000 employees reaching out to somebody that's struggling in their community. What that alone would do to Norway. Amazing. So I'm going to be, you go hear more about that from me in the United States soon. I'm coming to a theater near you for the message. I'll heal America. Bring America back together again.
Okay.
Yeah, stop it. I meant to give the floor further, but I think we close it with that.
There's something
that
called so jump after Virkola.
Exactly. It's not your values. So thank you so much, dear panel. It was great listening to all of you. And thank you so much, David. And with that, we give the panel a big applause. Don't we? And Bodega. But Vegard, the floor is yours, and I'm so curious to hear what you're going to sum up.
Yeah, truth is, I always loved being invited to do wise reflections in a few minutes, a little bit on overtime, after doing panels all day. So thanks, I've been looking forward to it. I think I'll simply, you know, there's nothing more to say about food. Fantastic to listen to the minister and Mr. Beasley and Raitana and Gabriele. I'll simply end by a short story about hope and cooperation. Because being in this world, working with these issues, you can feel that polarization, you know, and the lack of progress and problem is what we're dealing with. That's part of the story. But there is another main story about the world. That's a story about progress and what we've been able to achieve. Because remember, in the 1950s, 2 out of 3 people globally were extremely poor. So we were 6 people here on stage. 4 of us, we were 3 people, would have had hardly anything to live by. Today, it's approximately 1 out of 10 people. China was approximately as poor as Zambia or Kenya or Ghana in the 80s, in the 1980s. Now there are hardly any extremely poor people in China. India, Mr. Nilekani, our guest is here, from 2015, more than 130 million people have worked themselves out of poverty in India. Since the turn of the century, we have halved child mortality. and maternal mortality is down 40%. And so people sometimes say to me, oh, Bård, you know, it's numbers. You use all those numbers. Maybe I do. But it's not numbers to the child who lives. And it's not numbers to her mother who lives to tell the story or feed the child. It's real progress. And, you know, we also have the ability to cooperate. It's not true what some people are saying. That we are, by heart, we are egoists. We're fighting out. We, as a species, we have it in us. Separates us from other species, our ability to have advanced cooperation. And look what we have been able to do in meeting the biggest challenges. We have fought pandemics. We've fought extreme ideologies, fascism or communism. We've fought, we've risen after the world wars, one time, two times. We're able to do it. It's just that, you know, it is hard. And sometimes it seems that we need a real wake-up call, like a war or a pandemic or an extreme ideology. And now the food crisis, which is in the intersection of climate change and biodiversity and the social and economic situation and development on the other side, we need people like you and others to give us that wake-up call. We need to rise to the challenge. And that's, I think, what this panel has been about and the work that all of you and we from Norasad are involved in. Thanks for a great show here. Great to see you. Keep up the good work. Thank you.
Okay, that's it for this afternoon. Thank you very much to our prominent guests. And it was a very inspiring, wonderful wake-up call for all of us. So brothers and sisters, hope and cooperation. And all my key takeaway, all equal, all very special. Take that home with you this evening. Thank you very much and thank you. Goodbye.